You know, it's a little bit strange wording for us if we put it in a different terminology that we would use more today. He did it with an oath. It says he didn't do it without an oath, so that means he did it with an oath. So Christ came in and was made a priest with an oath. And we talked about the oath last week, or 2 weeks ago. When God made his promise to Abraham, he did it with two immutable things. And what were those? The first thing that God gave to Abraham was what? A promise. And when God promises something, we said you can take it to the bank. In chapter 6, it tells us that there are some immutable things. That means we can't get over them. They're so solid, they're so foundational, they're so truthful, there's no way to get around them. And in two ways, and by the way, the scriptures tell us God cannot lie. God made his covenant with Abraham. He did it with a promise, and God's promise is solid. It's unwavering. It will happen. And then he confirmed it with what? What did he confirm the promise with? An oath. How many times does God usually do that? How many times do you see God confirming something with an oath? And why did God do that? At least, what is the Hebrew writer trying to explain to us why God did that? He wants them to have the utmost assurance that God will do what he said. And so he says, God not only made a promise, which is rock solid, but he confirmed it with an oath. And that's like God saying, not only did I promise to you, but I'm guaranteeing that I'm going to fulfill that promise. And that's the idea of confirming it with an oath. And so if you're a Christian, you're a Hebrew Christian, and you're wavering whether to go back into Judaism or to maintain your Christian beliefs that you've been taught through the gospel, then you should have to pay attention to that. The fact that God has made this kind of promise. So here is the high priest that we have in front of us now that's being presented by the writer of Hebrews, who's saying this high priest was confirmed with an oath. Now that's solid. Okay, let's read on. Verse 21. For those priests were made, and those priests he's talking about under the old law, verse 21. For those priests, contrasting this priest, who is Christ, against those priests who were under the old law, for those priests were made without an oath. Now it's not like God needs to give us an oath. But if God is going to confirm something with an oath, it's hard to explain for us to understand how that is so much more powerful. So God allowed them to be selected priest, but there was no oath involved in it. So what the message is here, as we read on, is the fact that God, he set this priest up, and this priest was confirmed or are singled out, are set apart with an oath. And these other priests, under the priesthood of Aaron, were not put in place with an oath. For those priests were made without an oath, but this, that is Christ, with an oath, by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now notice what he says here. Here is God saying, this is the priest that I am going to bring to you. Now what does he tell us about that priest? He's after the order of Melchizedek, which we understand, we've done a little bit of studying on that. But what else does he tell us about this priest? He's a priest forever. I'm establishing this man as your high priest, and I've confirmed him with an oath which never has been done with any other priest. And he's not going to ever go away. Okay? So here you are, and you're struggling. And you're saying, well, you know, do we go back to the old ways with the priest from the tribe of Aaron? And the message is, no, listen, I've given you a high priest confirmed with an oath that will never go away. And so this is who we should be listening to, and that's the message that's being given to these Hebrew Christians. So he says in verse 22, by so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament or covenant. Now look at the wording there. By so much, what's he telling us here? What was involved in it? What's significant about this priest compared to other priests? He's not going to change. He has been given to you, not selected by the elders or other priests that were in the priesthood and said, well, I think this person over here is going to be a good priest. Let's get him prepared to be a priest, and let's groom him or whatever, and then let's put him in. Okay? How did they select priests? Did God come down and say, I want this person, this person, this person to be the priest? No, the men chose him. Now all of a sudden, here's God saying, this man's going to be the priest. Now, isn't that a little significant? You've got men selecting priests all of a sudden, and then now God's going to come in and say, this man's a priest. He's going to be your high priest. That's pretty significant, isn't it? And not only that, he has confirmed him with an oath. And he is a priest that will be continual. He will not go away. He'll be a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And so he says, by so much was Jesus made a surety. We've talked about this before. You guys want to guarantee your future by listening to what banks and financial institutions can offer you, even with the guarantee that you're going to be covered, that you're insured if something happens? How far does that go? How good do you feel about that? Oh, my bank or my financial institution's insured up to so many millions of dollars. How good do you feel about that? All it takes is for something to go awry, which certainly can happen, and they can take it away from you. Those of you who have Social Security, those of you who have retirement from some company, have you seen any of this happen before? So-and-so announced today that the retirement that was being paid to all their employees is no longer going to be covered. It happens. We have nothing in this world, as much as we like to think that we do, that is guaranteed. Social Security may be gone in as little as 4 years. Think about it. All we need is an administration and a right number of people voting on it, and it can be gone. So we have nothing that's certain in this world, even though we like to think that we do. But here is someone who God has said, he is the priest forever. And it says that he was done so with so much surety. Now, you stop and think about it. If God is behind something, how much can we take stock in it? If God is saying, that the old law and the old priesthood was not perfect earlier in the chapter. So what are we going to do with it? What's going to happen to it? It's going to go away. But here's a high priest that is going to be of a certainty, who's never going to go away. Now, which one do you want to follow? The one that God says is going away, or the one that God says will last forever? And so, you know, open your eyes, Hebrew Christians. Open your eyes to what God is providing for you. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. And they truly were many priests. And there we see the number. There were many priests over here. But why? Because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. Why do we have so many priests under the old law? They were men. They were going to die. Here we have a priest that, according to the scripture, after the order of Melchizedek, we looked back a few verses and it said that Melchizedek had no beginning and no ending. Don't know if Melchizedek was somebody put in place by God that was an eternal being. Don't know that. Don't know if it just meant that his beginning wasn't known about, his ending wasn't known about. But whatever, you get the understanding that Christ is forever. These men died. There were many priests. And there were many priests because they died a physical death. But this man, verse 24, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Now, I don't know exactly how it might have been under the law of Moses. But let's just say, for an example, here you've grown up, and this is the priest, this is the high priest that your family's gone to. He knows you. He knows about you. He knows your family. And, you know, you have some confidence in him. You listen to what he says. You lean on him to provide understanding and guidance as a man of God, as we would not say. Well, what happens here in a few years? He's gone. Now someone takes his place. It's like, who are you? They may be nice, they might be cordial, but they don't know you. How do you feel around them? Until you get that relationship built up, yeah, he's the new high priest, but he doesn't know me, doesn't know anything about me, doesn't know my family. How does that feel compared to someone who never changes? I know all of us have probably had to go through a change with a doctor. If we had a doctor we really trusted in, and for whatever reason he retired or death took him or whatever, that's a little awkward, isn't it? Go into the office of a new doctor, say, you know, nice to meet you, but don't know a thing about you. We don't like that too much, do we? So these men died. And whatever service they provided, they could not continue it on. But here's Christ, who is a priest forever. Now, if I go to Christ as the priest, and I say to him as our high priest, you know, I'm struggling, you know. He's able to say, I know. It's not the first time you struggled. I remember when you struggled, whatever. And here I am to help you. You see the comfort in that? Here's a high priest that's not going to change. I don't have to worry about tomorrow, the fact that he's gone and someone else is taking his place. I have a high priest that is continuing forever. And he knows me and he can represent me and he knows what I need in my life. And it's so much better than someone who is there and then maybe is gone. And so they didn't continue because of death, but this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the utmost that come unto God by him. What could the priest do in the law of Moses? Provide any salvation? No. So here's a priest who is not only able to do the priestly duties that needs to be done, but look at what he says. He is also able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. If we come to God by Jesus Christ, he is able to save us by the skin of our teeth, or just barely save us. What does he say there? He can save them to the utmost. Now, what does utmost mean to you? As far as it goes, the maximum amount. Jesus is able to save you to the maximum amount. Now, I don't know how you would necessarily equate that to salvation, but the message here is that not only is he your high priest that's not going to ever change, but he's a high priest that can save you, who can bring you salvation because of his relationship with God. No other priest ever could come close to any of that. No other priest can provide salvation. And not only does he provide salvation, it says he's able to do it to the utmost. To the full extent, he is able to save those that would come unto God by him. Seeing he ever liveth to make intercessions for us. Boy, I'll really be glad when I can, 2 or 3 months from now, when I can go to that high priest and I can say, you know, I've had the weight of these sins on me for the last year, and I'm just ready to get them off, and I'll be glad when you can go through the ceremony of entering into the most holy place and to offer sacrifices for my sins so I can sort of feel a little bit better about it for a while. Now compare that to someone who is constantly, it says here, he is ever, he living and making intercessions for us. I want to feel good about my relationship with God and the Savior Jesus Christ. There he is in the most holy place ever continually making intercessions for me. I'm struggling. Then here's Christ representing me to God. Through the throne on high, he is there making intercessions for me. This individual, this child needs support. This child needs to be comforted. This child needs to be encouraged. Well, can we, I sure wish we could hurry this up. I need the encouragement now, but I need to feel better now, but the sacrifice is not going to be happening for 6 more months now. Do you see that? Make him as clean as anybody else, white as snow in front of the Father of heaven. He has that ability. But you see the idea there, what I'm trying to get to. The priests that were under the law of Moses, they could only offer sacrifices for the people on certain occasions. And as far as the atonement that they would go through, where they would offer sacrifices once a year, could you see that kind of situation? And I feel bad about this, but I can't go in and do anything about it for 6 months or 8 months or whatever. But Jesus is ever making intercessions for us in heaven. Now, which one do you want? That's the question that the Hebrew Christians have to answer as they waver in their faith. For such a high priest became us. Man, that's beautiful. For such a high priest became us. How do you explain that? To understand that, it takes some thought. I'm not sure we can ever get there. But do you realize what he did for us? We've talked about this before. Would it have been possible for Jesus to just say, yeah, let me just sort of flash down to earth. Let me be there. If you want me to die in the human form, that's fine. I'll go down and I'll be a human, fully grown person, and I'll just go ahead and die on the cross, and then I'll just come back to heaven. And then as we look at him as someone who is sympathetic to our problems and our difficulties and our sorrows and our tears, we say, he doesn't know what we've been through. But Jesus became us. Oh, he knows what you're going through. And he can stand in front of the Father and say, look, I've been there where this guy's been or this woman's been. I know what they're going through. Here's what I want you to do for them. That's who you have up there. And that is so much better than somebody who typically couldn't know all the people that came to him to be able to make sacrifices for all the people. He couldn't know everybody in the old law. And I think, after a while, our tendency is to become sort of robotic and ritualistic. And I think the priest on the old law said, okay, it's now time again to offer those sacrifices for the people. I'll go in it. And I'm not saying they weren't sincere in what they were doing, but they didn't know us. They couldn't have known those people. But Jesus became us. He became you Hebrew children, you Christians who are suffering. He became you. He knows what to say to the Father. He knows what you need. That's a powerful verse. For such a high priest became us. This is the same thing you're talking about is just continuation in this verse. This high priest became us who is holy. He is God. He was harmless. He was undefiled. He was separate from sinners. And he's made higher than the heavens. Yes, he became us, but he was holy. He didn't sin. He, even though ate with sinners, he was not a sinner himself. He was separate from sinners. He was harmless. He didn't come out here and try to show his power in any way other to confirm that he was the Son of God with the miracles that he did. He was undefiled. Being in the world of sin and temptation, he was undefiled. And he's been made higher than the heavens. Who needeth not daily, as those priests, to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. For this he did once when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity. But the word of the oath, which was since the law, and what that means there, which was preceding the law, which was before the law, the oath was in effect before we ever had Moses and Aaron on the scene, right? The oath was confirmed, or the promise was confirmed with an oath back with Abraham. And so he says, for the law maketh men high priests which have infirmities, but the word of the oath, which was since the law or before the law, maketh the Son who is consecrated forevermore. And the American Standard says, who is perfected forevermore. Now, when you have received or have achieved perfection, how much better can you get? You can't, can you? And here is the Son of God who was able to take care of the sins of the people one time. And through the suffering that he went through, he was perfected. And because of that, he is the ultimate high priest who continues forever and is constantly making intercessions for us. It would be hard, and we're not there, and we don't know the circumstances, but it seems like it would be very difficult for the Hebrew Christians to not see the difference of the picture that's being painted in front of them of the Levitical priest and the priest that's after the order of Melchizedek. So much better. Now, we're going to continue into chapter 8 some little bit, but we won't make it today. But we'll see, it says, it's interesting, it says, now the things which we have spoken, we've talked a lot here, it says, this is the sum. So you might want to read that. This is the sum. Let's flip over in our books to... let's see, what page are we on here? 84. And let's take a look here at some of these fill-in-the-blank activities. I'm not sure we're going to make all of them today, but we'll get started. Where do we find number one? Verse 4? Okay. And as we said before, each number, 1, 2, 3, represents the chapter. So this is chapter 1, verse 4. And what does he say there? Being made so much better than the angels. Who are we talking about here? Christ. Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by what? Inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Now, when someone has a will and they die, and let's say it was some landowner, there are those who are going to receive some benefits from that that might have been the workers underneath that landowner, and they're going to maybe be given a piece of land. They might be given a little house or something to go along with it that was on the land they're already living in. They've worked for that family so long, and they're going to be blessed because of that. And so the landowner says, okay, I'm going to give you that house you've been living in and a few acres to go along with it. Okay? That's not unreasonable. Probably happened somewhere in the past. Maybe even here in this county. I don't know. But what about the direct heir to that man, the son of that man? What kind of inheritance is he going to get? Much more. Now, you think he worked as hard as some of those people who worked? Maybe not. Maybe he did. Maybe not. Maybe he didn't work as hard as they did. But he has a better inheritance because of who he is, right? And so here Jesus, as we start talking about, okay, in chapter 1, God who at sundry times and in divers manners and times past spoke to us by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us through his Son. And the message here is, we know you've been raised by listening to the prophets and the teachers and messengers from God, but now you don't have to do that anymore. The Son is here and you can listen to him. And the idea is, we start out in Hebrews, is that they need to be able to understand that something has happened in their lives, the gospel, that's different than what they were a part of in Judaism. And so he says here that this who has come to you is better. He has a better inheritance. He has a better name. He's coming directly from God. He's not a messenger from God. He is God in the flesh. And he's here to talk to you. So he's so much better than these angels, and he's so much better than all those who've come before. And you need to listen to him. All right, number 2, chapter 2. What verse do we have? Verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? If we have had in the past angels from God, if we have had messengers from God, prophets and fathers of heads of households who were recipients of the message of God and have passed it on, if we have now someone who is so much far superior to those, and what's going to happen if we neglect to listen to him? We're not going to escape. They couldn't provide salvation. He can. They were not the very image of God or the manifestation of God in the flesh. He was. And if he comes and tells us about salvation and has the power to do that, and we neglect that, the question is, how shall we escape? If we neglect that salvation, we can't escape. They are in difficult times here, and the question is, how is it that you're going to reach your ultimate goal of salvation if you neglect the message from the Son of God? And the answer is, we can't escape. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? All right, number 3. Verse 3, chapter 3. For this man, we're talking about Christ, this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses. Now, how do you think they felt about Moses? Moses was the lawgiver. Moses was the one who led the people up to the promised land. Moses did many, many things. He got them out of Egypt. You look at Moses, he was the lawgiver. That, they look at that and say, Moses was significant. He was not somebody that was trivial in their minds. But he says here, here is a man that's worthy for more glory and honor than Moses. And why does he say so? Let's continue on. Inasmuch as he who hath built the house hath more honor than the house. Now, was Moses involved in the resurrection? What am I looking for here? I guess I'll choose another word. I can't get that one to come. Was Moses involved in the architecture of the tabernacle? No. Where did that come from? God. Who is the architect of the church? Christ is. He's the architect of the church. He's the builder of the church. And so he says here, if you look at the tabernacle, that's this building that they worshipped in. Later they built temples with the same kind of holy and most holy place. But he says, insomuch that he who hath built the house hath more honor than the house. Because it was in his mind. He was able to do it. Moses built the tabernacle. Solomon had the temple built. But where was the honor? Was it in the house or in the one who built it? And here we have Christ, who's the architect or the builder of the church. And so they have more honor than those who built it or who had the house in their presence. Who had the ability to cause the house to be. Moses would have gone forever. And if you said, Moses, build me a tabernacle. What would he have done? No idea. But it wouldn't have been what God had wanted. And so the one who prescribes or is the designer of that house has more honor than the house itself. And so Moses was not someone that should have looked upon and said, well, you're the architect of this tabernacle. No. He wasn't. And so here we have Christ, who is counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who hath built the house hath more honor than the house. All right, number 4. Verse 12. For the word of God is quick. What's another word for that? Sharp. It goes on to talk about that. But when we talk about something being quick, living, alive. The word of God is alive. It's not dead. The word of God is alive. It's quick. And what else? Powerful. And sharper than any two-edged sword. The word of God is alive. And it's powerful. And this is what they were supposed to be listening to, the word of God. And God had spoken to the people in times past. He had given them guidance. But the idea here was that the word that was spoken by Moses and others had pre-described limitations. It was good to a point in time. And once that time came, that word didn't have the value that it did previously because time had been fulfilled. But God's word is powerful. It's still powerful today. We'll pick up there and try to finish up through number 7, and then we'll get on into chapter 8 as we have the time.